tends to be evangelical. I mean, churches like the, you know, Presbyterianism, Methodism, I mean, these are dying religions. Reform and conservatism, in some respects, are having the same kinds of problems. They're having problems attracting young people. I think, for one thing, there's it may be an age issue to some extent, and that is to say that, particularly, I've noticed in some Reform congregations and some conservative congregations where the rabbis are very, very much kind of grew up in the sort of social justice tradition and tend to be kind of weak on the spiritual side. And I think younger Jews tend to be more spiritually inclined. And so I think they find the experience in a lot of conservative Reform places simply unsatisfying. I mean, Reconstructionism I really can't speak very authoritatively about, except to say that it's, you know, provided a way to be Jewish to a lot of gay Jews. I mean, I think, you know, that's been a benefit. Apart from that, I mean, I have to say my experience in Reconstructionist settings has been mostly negative, because they are so sort of violently, autonomically, politically leftist that I find myself just kind of lost in that setting. I can't put myself anywhere comfortably. But again, I think there's a failure to recognize the spiritual needs that people have, and that young people increasingly. I mean, I see in my neighborhood. I mean, on Shabbos here up on the Upper West Side, I see all these young, attractive folks walking around, going to shul, going out, you know, going out enjoying the Shabbos. I mean, clearly there is a rise. I mean, the only movement that seems to be alive these days is modern Orthodoxy, and obviously it's providing some kind of spiritual answer. And I think also younger Jews tend to be politically more conservative, and also, I mean, look, I mean, there's a direct correlation between religious observancy and greater political conservatism across the board, in all religions, and I think we're seeing that to some extent. But, you know, more broadly speaking, we simply have, you know, we have the bowling alone phenomenon. People aren't joiners very much anymore, and that includes young Jews for the most part. So that, you know, I'm sort of delighted to see these young people going to modern Orthodox shuls, because I want people to remain Jewish and make Jewish kids and all of that. And yet I know that most kids, you know, if I think of my own family, most young people are not, they don't tend to be involved. And I'm particularly disturbed by the tremendous falling away from any kind of strong tie to Israel that one feels among young Jews. And I suspect, I mean, the reasons are probably obvious. The university culture, what they're getting from their professors, what they're getting from the general environment, which is Occidentalist, which is anti-American, which sees Israel as a running dog, which sees Palestinians as the oppressed. I mean, this culture of aggrievement, and Israel's faring badly, and these young Jews are pretty ignorant. They don't know how to defend themselves. They tend to be very easily convinced by hostile arguments. But yeah, that troubles me actually quite a lot. That troubles me a lot.
It was interesting which group of Jews kept sending their children to Israel during the situation in 2000, 2001, 2002, and which movement suspended sending children to Israel during those years.
I'm sorry?
It was interesting which parts of Judaism kept sending their children to Israel during the situation of the suicide bombers, 2000 to 2002.
I don't know. I think probably the most people weren't evangelical Christians, but which kind of Jews went?
Well, yeah, evangelical Christians and Orthodox Jews.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm good for them. I'm glad to hear that. I mean, that is to say, the Zionist Orthodox Jews. I don't have to tell you, there are plenty who are not.
Right. How do you decide what is right and wrong?
How do I decide what is right and wrong?
Yeah.
Well, I've had a very good education, which doesn't hurt. I've read a lot of good literature and a lot of good philosophy, and I rely to a very considerable degree on the most important people I've read and who have influenced me most deeply, and those are writers and philosophers, some Jewish, some not. My own upbringing, I very often will go and talk to my brother-in-law, who's a rabbi, when I'm in a moral quandary. Obviously, I rely, like everyone else does, on experience. I try to actually weigh, I try also to employ reason, and that is to actually look at a situation in terms of, you might say, I suppose, utilitarian ethics. I mean, you know, where will the greatest, what will produce the greatest harm? What will produce the least harm? What will produce the most good, which is the least good option? And I spend a lot, I take a great deal of time weighing situations. I don't come to situations with ideological presuppositions. I'm not a person, I don't really believe in isms very much. I mean, when I was younger, I did. When I was younger, I certainly did. But I tend to look at things, I try to look at issues each separately, each at a time. I try to understand its connection to other things, of course. But I try to see the rights and the wrongs of it, and I try to learn about it. I mean, I think you have to know things. I mean, I'm a great believer in knowing things. And I think one of the things that's so so appalling about the nature of discourse and debate today, I mean, I suppose it's always been the case. I mean, one's always, you know, it's, you know, you get into sort of this lost tempora facti. I mean, things were always great at some past time, you know. One feels that people don't have any notion that knowing things actually is important in terms of coming to some kind of a conclusion. And I actually have that, and maybe it's 20 years of being a university professor. I really do believe in research, and I believe in reading things, and I believe in reading things I don't agree with, and I believe in weighing things with great care. And I don't come to positions quickly or easily, and I second guess, and I agonize, and I talk to lots of people on all sides. And again, I fall back on, you know, on the great writers. I fall back on those people who have provided me, you know, with whom I can commune. I mean, I was a professor of Victorian studies for a very long time, and you know, my great moral teacher is George Eliot, you know, I find myself, I've probably learned more about ethics reading Middlemarch than probably any other book in my life. But I read philosophers, and I read social scientists, and I try to look at things very, very carefully, and you know, maybe my answer is insufficient for you because I'm not, you know, saying the Tanakh, but I am not deeply versed in. I mean, I can do Hebraic pretty well when I have to, but you know, I don't. It's not the first thing that I turn to, although it's not something I would not turn to. I get well. What I have at my fingertips really is my brother-in-law. I mean, it's not an unimportant thing. I mean, I have someone that, you know, who I can always reach out to, who is deeply learned in Jewish thought and philosophy, and I talk to him several times a week. And certainly, you know, lately in the context of this miserable business I've been going through, he's been an enormous source of strength. And you know, I look to him and I will ask him, you know, are there passages I should be thinking about that speak to the situation I'm in? And he is a great, he is